Welcome to another tutorial for DaVinci Resolve Color Management and Fusion. In this video, I'm gonna deal with DaVinci Wide Gamut, the new color science in DaVinci Resolve 17. And if you ever tried to use it together with Fusion, you have likely observed two issues. First of all, if you have any picture which looks nice in the timeline, you head over to Fusion and the image looks immediately different in the Fusion viewer. So you see some problems with highlights here, something maybe too bright, too dark, colors maybe off, so it's just not matching the image from the edit page. And the second problem that you may have noticed is that if you just add simple text tools, Fusion text tools from the template library, like from the effects library, use a text plus tool for example, you see here that it's supposed to be white, but actually it looks gray, even though the simple edit title, which is the basic title here, this one looks fine, this one does not. And it's not just about white. If you're trying to match other colors, you will also be in trouble. So I will look specifically at these two issues. I will give you some quick workarounds and I will give you some more complex workarounds with the required background information to understand what's really happening. For the second part, you will hugely benefit from a bit of knowledge about color management. I have done previous tutorials about why we work in linear space and Fusion. I have also done tutorials about Resolve color management and aces. The topics are kind of recurring here. It is kind of the same issue I had before with aces. The workaround looks slightly different here, but if you want to look at those tutorials to get the full picture, please feel free, have a look. But now let me give you an idea what is happening here with DaVinci Wide Gamut. Let me start with the titles here, because there I can at least give you some simple fixes if all you need is like a white title. That shouldn't be too difficult, right? So you see here the edit title is white, the fusion title is not. And I can actually compare this if I open up the scopes, Control Shift W, or you find it somewhere in the menu, I've forgotten where, doesn't matter. Scopes, if I look at it and in the Fusion Inspector see what's happening with the Fusion title, I can go into shading and here I can actually bring up the value above one if I want to. So I can move it higher, I can make it like super white, go above white. And here I need to go pretty high, I think I tested it should be something like 45 or so, or maybe that was too much, maybe just 40. It doesn't matter, so if you really bring it up until the limit, at some point the white point will be matching. Now in principle you could also match other colors this way by, you know, manually entering values and trying to match it in the scopes. Obviously that's very cumbersome if you have more than one color and not really a great workaround, but if all you need is a white title, there you go. Let me bring this back to one. Next workaround for this particular problem, one of my trainer colleagues pointed this out, you can turn off DaVinci Wide Gamut from the color management section, work without it in Fusion, then render and then continue using the render. And this has become rather simple in Resolve 17 since there is this render in place function. So you could use it here. So here I have my mismatching title, but if I go to the color management and disable the DaVinci Wide Gamut, so I mean just to, you know, proof that I'm really in DaVinci Wide Gamut, that's what I'm doing right now. Let me disable it. I just go to DaVinci YRGB, which is without the color management, so you have to manage yourself. So let me go here. And after a second, it will update. Now the title is matching. I have a white title. And now I want to render this, render in place. I think it does not work on the title as far as I'm, even though the menu is here, but when I click on it, nothing actually happens. But it does work on a clip level and you can put everything into a clip just by making a compound clip. So I just want the fusion title. I just make a compound clip. And on this compound clip, I can do render in place here. And I can choose the file format. You want to choose one which has an alpha channel. In this case, if you have like a title with transparency, then the 4x4 options from DNxHR or from ProRes, if you're on Mac, you will see the ProRes formats, they have the same. So this 4x4 option has an alpha channel. And so choose one of those. And here I have to choose a folder where I want to save it. Actually, let me just select the one I have here. And then it's rendering and then my clip here is replaced. If you right click now, you see decomposed original, so you can go back, which is kind of nice. But yeah, now it's rendered. Now let's see if that worked. So if I go back to the color management, go back to color managed, and go back to DaVinci Wide Gamut, save, and it takes a second to update. And I think it did. Let's check here. Yeah, I think it did. And the title is still white. Okay, so my second workaround for the title is also working. So if you have multiple colors or so, a more complex fusion graphic, that would be a quick way to bring it over into DaVinci Wide Gamut without doing anything more sophisticated. The next better solution, however, involves understanding more about color management, because so far we just solved the problem somehow without knowing what's going on. But if you do some manual color transformations, you have more options to handle this. I will show you this first on the image. I will show you how I can get my Fusion Viewer to display correctly with DaVinci Wide Gamut. And then I can kind of invert that solution to work backwards towards a solution for, again, the graphics problem. Let me start by explaining to you what I can do with the Fusion Viewer. So here I have just a photograph, doesn't matter whatever it is, any clip, HDR, whatever. I bring it over to Fusion and the highlights here get distorted. It doesn't look correct. And the problem here is that the managed view LUT doesn't really work with color management. Well, it does work with color management, but it does not work with ACES and it doesn't work with DaVinci Wide Gamut. And the problem is that the managed view LUT here is purely based on a simple gamut transform that you have in Fusion, that you already had in Fusion Studio. But this conversion is not considering the reference transform. So this display reference transform that is happening as part of ACES or that is happening as part of DaVinci Wide Gamut. So DaVinci Wide Gamut does a color space transform and then there's some kind of contrast adjustments towards the output. So there's some additional transformation in there, which is just not happening here. So with this tool, which is built in and where the managed view LUT is based on, you cannot really do it. And well, that's why it looks bad. What you can do is you can circumvent it. So let me do this. First of all, you can disable it. And in this case, I would disable the add gamma and I would go here to no change. So now I have disabled LUT. Actually, you can turn it off. But I think I'm already thinking one step ahead. I want to show you one other thing with the view LUT. So that's why I disabled it. But here, just turn it off. For the first step, just turn it off. And then we have to do something manually. Now, what do we have to do manually? Let me look again into the settings and show you what the settings exactly are. So these are these presets in DaVinci Resolve 17. But if you go to custom, then the current preset is copied into custom. And in the custom area, you can see exactly what's happening. So you have an input color space, Rec 709, you have a timeline color space, you have a timeline luminance, and you have output color space. And then you have this display reference transform both on input side and output side. I'm showing you this in case you are changing anything here. You will also have to change the things in the workaround, or if you're using ACES, for example, you would also have to look into it and, you know, build the transforms accordingly. So I'm building now a manual transformation to go from my linear fusion space back to the output transform, doing the output transform from DaVinci Resolve. And I do this now manually instead of using the managed view LUT. So this I can cancel and I can do this manually with two tools, actually two times the same, shift spacebar for the tools. And then there is the color, there is the color space transform tool. And let me just connect it and bring it into the viewer. And what do I need to do? In Fusion, I am working in linear color space. From the edit page to here, DaVinci Resolve has transformed to linear color space. So it has removed the gamma curve. That's why this image looks too dark. So let me fix that first. So I go from the input color space linear. So let me choose gamma linear here. Where is it? Linear. From linear gamma, I go to the timeline color space. And the timeline color space is the DaVinci intermediate. So I change the gamma from linear to DaVinci intermediate here. And I disable the tone mapping. So for now, this is the type of transform that Fusion would be doing internally. And actually, since this is use timeline, I could also just leave use timeline, right? So it's the same, doesn't change. Use timeline, it uses the information from the timeline, but goes from linear gamma back to the timeline gamma. So Fusion uses the same settings, but linear gamma in the timeline I have now converted. Now things look a bit not as dark anymore, right? So I'll show you side by side. So this was where I'm coming from in Fusion, that's dark, that's typical for linear image. And then this one here looks kind of flat, which is typical for like log footage, and this DaVinci intermediate space is kind of similar to a logarithmic space. Actually, it is one technically, and that looks a little bit flat. So from here, I need to go to the output space, and I now replicate the transform that DaVinci Resolve is doing when it takes the timeline space to the output space. I can do this again with the same type of color space transform. Let me just copy and paste this and bring it into the viewer. But this time I stick to my input color space. I use the timeline space. Output color space, I use my output setting for the output in the color management settings, which was Rec 709 Gamma 2.4. If you remember before what I showed you, my settings, these are the standard settings for DaVinci Intermediate, by the way, so Rec 709 Gamma 2.4. And now I need to do tone mapping. So here in the first transform, I didn't do any tone mapping. In the second one, I need to do it. Oh, and sorry, here again, the managed view LUT is on because now I have two viewers. I have to turn it off in both of them. Let me turn it off. Right, so again, so this was the log type without the view LUT, and here it's now with the transform to Rec 709. This is the transform to Rec 709 without tone mapping. So if I disable the tone mapping in the color management, this would already be correct. If you do use the tone mapping, which in the custom settings, you have different options for the tone mapping. You have the options here. You can use luminance mapping. You can use DaVinci mapping. So the DaVinci setting is the standard tone mapping from the wide gamut color management. And in this tone mapping, I am going from my input. I always have to think which way I go. I think I go like this. So I have my timeline. Let me show you again the settings. I have my, let me go to customs. I have my timeline working luminance, which is set to HDR 4000, which is a luminance of 4000 nits. So this is in the setting here. Here I have to manually, unfortunately, I don't have the same presets. So I have to manually enter this. So I have to use this same setting as my input because I am coming from this timeline space, going to my output space, and coming from this timeline space, I am doing a forward transform. This stands for optical to optical transform function, I think. I am not a colorist, I'm just a Fusion guy who wish I could just work in linear workspace and not care about all of this. If you are a colorist, feel free to explain all of this. I just figured out how I needed to set it up for Fusion and pass this on, so sorry about this. Nonetheless, so now the tone mapping is set up. This is going forward, and what I'm seeing in this viewer here, let me make it large, this should now match exactly what I see on the edit page. And when I test these things, I typically make a screenshot and then make another screenshot and put them over each other to make sure this is 100% the case. But let me go back to the edit page, and yeah, I think in the switch, I hope you can agree that this looks exactly the same. And let me go again to this node, right? So I have created my own transform from linear back to the, not to the edit page, but to the final output transform, the way it's being displayed in the edit page. So I have created this manually. Having this, I can use this to have the correct view in the Fusion page. I just have to attach these two nodes wherever I want to view it. So what you might do, maybe you want to group them or make a Fusion macro out of it, which you can then add at the end. So if you want, you could just Control G group them. And if you want, you can, by the way, a Fusion group, you can also settings save as, and you can save it into your macro folder, like Fusion macro folder, can set it here. Let me just do it. This is like the fastest way to get a macro. You can also use the macro editor if you know it. So this is wide gamut to rec 70924, gamma 2.4. Let me just save it like this, and then you should be able to get it even from here. So you can just get it from your tool selection from now on. And you could just add it to the end of the flow and just bring this into the viewer and work however you like. And if you need to see anything in between, you would have to attach this node. This is inconvenient compared to just selecting a LUT. I understand this. However, the tools that I needed to create this are not available up here in the Fusion LUT menu. So I'm unable to put it into the LUT menu. If you watch the ACES tutorial, in case of ACES, there is a workaround using OCIO view LUTs. It's also a not so easy workaround. You have to install something, but at least there is a workaround. Here in this case, I can think of two workarounds. One would be a macro view LUT, which used to work in Fusion Studio. Whenever I tried it recently, I got an instant crash, so I'm not even trying to show that to you. Another workaround to really get it in here would be to create a LUT manually. Now, the idea of color management is usually to kind of get rid of those type of LUTs, and any LUT, like I'm not talking about the Fusion curve LUTs, I'm talking about the kind of LUTs you have, like file LUTs, right? Those type of LUTs are somewhat destructive. They're somewhat approximations. They can lead to banding depending on the quality settings. So there are downsides to these LUTs. There are reasons why we usually don't use them. But since we are in the world of crappy workarounds here, if you are using this frequently and you need a quick way to switch to a LUT here in the LUT menu, you could do the same steps that I just did and create a LUT from this, which you can then load here. Actually, I've done that once before. You can do it from the color page. These transform nodes, they are Resolve FX nodes, which are available in the color page. So if you know how to create a LUT from the color page, you can create your own LUT with these two tools the same way I created them here. Just create a LUT from it. Fun fact, just for advanced users, you can even create a LUT in Fusion. I don't know if you knew this, but let me just show you, just for the fun of it. There are tools for this. If I enter here LUT, there are two tools. There is a LUT cube creator. Let me add this into the flow, and a LUT cube analyzer. And what this does is one of them creates a colorful test pattern, which looks like this. So this is like a color test stripe kind of, and then you do whatever you want in Fusion on this test image, and then the analyzer takes the result of this and puts it into a file, and that is your file LUT. So if you ever need to create a LUT from Fusion, you could do this. There is a resolution to this, so size 33, that's relatively low, so probably you want to increase this. I'm not sure what the in DaVinci Resolve in the color page. I think the next level you just have two or three options in the color page. I think the next one is 65, if I'm not mistaken. So you can increase this and get more test patches and get higher resolution in your LUT. And then you can choose the LUT type. And this is all coming from Fusion Studio. I think in DaVinci Resolve, you have, if you want to use the same on the color page for some reason, all of these work in Fusion. But in the color page, I think the last one, 3DL, I think works. Again, I'm not a colorist and not super interested into this, but yeah, let's just create this test for wide gamut. So I just give it a name, save, not valid. Oh, it needs a file extension maybe. .3DL, is that the reason? Okay. And then write file. And it'll appear in my Resolve LUT folder now, which I can copy here. Or actually, because it is the Resolve LUT folder, I think I will see it immediately. Yeah, so here I have the LUT. And now I can enable this one. Sorry, I can enable this. Select it, bring back the image from the media out. And turn on the LUT. And now if I click on Edit, you see why I initially wanted to disable the Managed View LUT. Because you can't really delete the Managed View LUT. You can only like disable it like this. And turn it off like this, no change. So disable it this way And then let me see if the other one got enabled. So this one got enabled. Okay, that didn't work. So this is annoying. It should be on. Let me do. Sometimes I notice that there's a problem via this menu. If you can't enable it here, do a right click here and check here. Sometimes I notice that there are differences here. So now there's a Fusion View LUT. That's interesting. Let's have a look at this. Edit Fusion View LUT. Okay, well, that also works. So Fusion View LUT selected here. Interesting. And now it's there, finally. So yeah, there are bugs in the LUT management. My main concern isn't really those bugs. My main problem is the Manage View LUT itself, which is not really a bug, but more like a feature gap. But there are also some bugs with adding and removing additional LUTs, which is also annoying. Nonetheless, we got there, so I loaded the LUT file into the Fusion View LUT, and the Manage View LUT again is disabled, right? So you can have multiple LUTs on top of each other in Fusion. So this way I should be again where I was before with my other workaround. So let's look at it side by side. So one option is the View LUT, the other option was using this. So left, right, and I'm getting this image here. And well, you see that the tonal range is kind of correct. If I look into the clouds, it looks pretty much the same. So this looks good, but in the highlights, I see some problems here. And well, I think it is due to the LUT creation process here. So at the end, all the mapping happens just based on these 65 patches. You can try to increase the number of test patches in your LUT and it might get a little bit better, but at the end you are using like a discrete kind of transformation for a relatively radical change between linear and nonlinear. So this is really LUTs you would typically, these file LUTs which I just used, you would usually avoid. But well, again, we are in the world of crappy workarounds, so if you just need a quick way to look into the viewer and kind of get an idea how bright it is, you could use this. However, I think this transform down here that I showed you before without the LUT is the better way, and here you see really why it's the better way. Even better if Blackmagic Design fixes this someday and enhances the managed view LUT. One can always hope. All right, so this was for the transformation to replace the managed view LUT to do the output transformation manually. Now let me show you how I can do the transformation from the other side, from the title. Let's say I go to the, let me go back to the edit page once, and let's make this even more obvious with the title. Let me go back. So I do the decompose to original to go back to my Fusion title and decompose the compound clip that I created. So now I have again two titles. One of them is the Fusion title. And to make it really obvious, let me use another color. I think it's even clearer if you use something like this maybe. So if I use this color, okay, let me use this color swatch here. Yeah, so I put it in a color swatch and then try to match this. Let's say I want to match a color here, and you see it's not matching, it's much brighter, and the problem is again the color management. So let me go to Fusion on this title effect, and now in Fusion, because I have my macro, I can first of all see how it looks like on the edit page. I can add my white gamut macro that I just created. So this is now on the right side, we see how it looks like at the moment on the edit page. On the left side, we see how it looks like in Fusion. And in Fusion, now we have to kind of fix this. And the best way I think to do this is if we want to see it in Fusion, the way it appears on the edit page would be to invert this transformation. So kind of go backwards. That way I can design it in Fusion based on my eyesight, based on how I see it in the viewer, and then make sure that it looks the same way. The reason that it is different in Fusion is that in Fusion, the text tool just creates a linear image, and then in the media out, the media out does the conversion from linear to the DaVinci wide gamut intermediate. However, it is a bit inconvenient to work with the DaVinci wide gamut space without seeing it, right? To look at this, but see this is a bit inconvenient. So it's not really a technical mistake. It's just that the Fusion tool isn't color space aware. It's not working differently for different color spaces. It always works in linear. So it always generates a linear output. And the colors that I select here, they match the sRGB color space. So yeah, that's why what I see here is not what I get at the end. So again, it's not really a bug of this tool. This tool is just not designed to work in other color spaces. It's just creating, like everything in Fusion, it's creating stuff for linear, and then in the transform back to the edit page, that's where things look different. So now let's make this tool kind of color space aware by creating our own transform, so that what we are seeing here is what is coming out here at the end. I have to do the same thing kind of in reverse that I did here before. So I have to add two color space transform nodes, and with the first one I am going from Rec 709, and I can do the same. I really go reverse from where I started. So I go from Rec 709 Gamma 2.4, go to the timeline space, which is the DaVinci Resolve Intermediate. I can enter it here or keep timeline. I use the tone mapping here, and in this case it's the reverse, so I have to use the custom output, set this to 4000 nits, which is the HDR timeline limit. So I go in this way, and I have to go in reverse, so I have to go inverse here. Before I went, I just have to do the opposite of what I did before. What did I do before? Let me check again in this group. So here it was, so here I did the forward transform. Now I do the inverse transform. Yeah, and same here. Before I used the maximum input, now I use the maximum output. So I do exactly the opposite to what I did here. So that was the first node. And then the second one, color space transform, in which I go from the intermediate to linear. So I put here linear, where is it? Sorry, gamma here, down here, gamma, linear. So, and I use no tone mapping in the second one. And this way, my left and my right viewers are matching, and I get here what I see here. Once again, why do I need two? Maybe you are thinking, okay, if I go from here, why can't I directly put output linear here? And you could try, and you will see that it's not matching. So if I do output linear here and disable this, you are not exactly getting the same. If you look closely, it's almost there, but it's not the same. And the reason is that the tone mapping transformation is defined on the intermediate space. So if you do the tone mapping on linear, you get something different compared to tone mapping on the intermediate. And yeah, that's the reason why I have to, let me undo this. So let me once again walk through the whole flow. So in the beginning, the text tool is normally outputting in linear. Fusion doesn't really know and doesn't care what you do. It just outputs RGB values, which are meant to be used in linear in Fusion. And in this case, I repurpose this and say, okay, this should be Rec 709 Gamma 2.4, so that what I see is what I want to have at the end. So I am going from my imaginary Rec 709 Gamma 2.4. From that, I do the transform into the timeline space with the correct tone mapping. From the timeline space, I go into linear for Fusion, and then the color management, which goes back to the edit page, brings it back. And then if you look into the edit page, this node here is of course only for me. I can delete this node again. I don't need this. If I go back into the edit page, I have the matching titles, and I only need to set this up once now. So if I switch, let's say I switch the color here. Let me try again just to confirm. If I use this color and now I want to use the same here, you can see that this is again matching, so I can match other colors. I can get white, I can get any color I want. Basically, this color swatch here now on the Fusion title, this color swatch now here is using the color exactly as I see it, as if this was a Rec. 709 gamma 2.4 defined color. This way I'm now using the color and it's being transformed back in Fusion and then via color management coming back. If I wanted to use this, of course I can create again a macro. I would take these two nodes here, put them into a group or make them into a macro. If I want to do this as part of compositing, I might have footage which is color managed correctly by the DaVinci Wide Gamut, and then I combine it with graphics and I would put this group here or this macro. If you export it as a macro, I would put this only on the graphics, but for the background footage, keep relying on the default color management. Okay, so these were the workarounds I can think of. As you see, it is quite technical if you manually do these kind of color conversions, and if you manually have to match something that DaVinci Resolve is doing automatically. On the other hand, if you are using things like Aces or DaVinci Wide Gamut, presumably you have a reason why you're doing this, and you hopefully have a little bit of technical background, because, well, the magical automatic settings are always great, but as soon as your workflow goes into some area that the default settings did not anticipate, it's getting a little bit difficult. So maybe you are outputting to other vendors, working with other VFX software, other tools. You know, these are always the cases where you have to think about, okay, how do I go from here to linear? How do I get back from linear? Now with Fusion, it's kind of sad that Blackmagic Design didn't anticipate this and gave us some better options out of the box. It's kind of sad that we have to do workarounds such as this here. But then again, this DaVinci Wide Gamut is relatively new. Blackmagic Design is aware of the problems. They must be. The forums are full with comments about this. But then again, you know, having some additional understanding how it works is quite beneficial. And if you do it, you once have to get this transformation for the settings that you're using. Maybe you're using a different tone mapping, maybe you're not using HDR 4000, but you're working in SDR, whatever it is, right? You have to see what settings you are using in your project. You have to once create those two conversions, the conversion to linear and the conversion from linear to mimic the output transform. If you have those two, you create them as macros, and then you can, you know, just via one click, you can basically use them. The LUT workaround again is even more crappy, I feel, so I'm not really recommending it, even though I have shown it to you just to get the limitations of that as well. And with this, you should hopefully be set if you want to use DaVinci Wide Gamut. All right, thanks for watching. Check out my other tutorials in the series. If you are looking for an advanced compositing training course or a beginner course, I have both. Have a look at my website and see you soon.